This program was recorded with a live audience. Please forgive the occasional sound fluctuations.
This program has a unique title. It's called It's Never Crowded Along the Extra Mile. And that is something that came to me many years ago from an observation in a poem called The Road Less Traveled. And I thought about that road less traveled a lot. And I've often said to my children, and I've observed it in my own life, that that whole idea of being willing to go the extra mile, that when you do that, you're always or almost always on what we call the road that is less traveled. It's not crowded out there. And I'm not talking here about principles or ideas or secrets for success and inner peace that have to do with getting ahead, with making more money than the next guy, with being better than anybody else, with accumulating a lot of things. I'm speaking here about the extra mile in which you are living a deeper and a richer experience of life. And that all of the other people that you run into in your life who are not there with you, or that you are observing living lives of turmoil and anxiety and worry and stress and so much of the stuff that occupies most people's lives is just not a part of your life any longer. And I believe there's a place that you can reach, and I believe these 10 principles, they're not just something that I said, all right, I got to come up with 10 things, so here, let's start numbering. I've been giving commencement speeches for the past 30 years. I've attended many, many commencements. It seems like every year I go to a commencement. When you have 8 children, they're always graduating from something, right? Whether it's nursery school or grade school or graduate school. And I've listened to a lot of these talks, and I've given a lot of these talks, and they always, of course, talk about how the word commencement means to commence, and that you're going to start, and this is just an opening and a beginning. And then most of the time, there is a launching into the means for being successful that have a lot to do with what I call the ego. That is evaluating who you are on the basis of how much you get and how much you achieve and what your reputation is. And these are not what the principles that I speak about at all in the commencement addresses that I've given, nor will they be the focus of this program and what we're speaking about here. I was handed a book when I was a young man, when I graduated from high school, by my uncle, called Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill. And I read it when I was in the Navy. I joined the Navy right after high school in 1958. And I was aboard ship out in the Pacific, and I just started reading this book. And it really wasn't about getting rich, I should say. It wasn't about making a lot of money. It was really about living a deeper and a richer experience of life. And he was making distinctions in there between people who are able to create a life in which they live everything that they want and are able to attract into their lives the things that are important to them, and the people who can't do those things. And in the process of reading it, I was immediately sorry that I had joined the Navy for 4 years. And I had 4 years ahead of me to contemplate trying to live in a system in which I was required to be just like everybody else, and a system in which I had to dress like everybody else, and a system in which having a mind of your own was, let's just say, it was not encouraged at that time. And it still isn't in those kinds of operations. And this isn't at all a put-down of the military in any way. It was, I began to realize at a very young age that there was something that was much deeper about creating a life of what I would like to have in my life. And I also realized that I had been doing a lot of it for most of my life up until that point. That growing up in a series of foster homes and orphanages as a young man, I had somehow been able to figure out naturally how to attract abundance into my life without being consumed with worry about scarcity and not having enough, if you will. I had been just fortunate enough to know that if I could put my mind and my thoughts and my attention on what it is that I wanted to create for myself, that I had the ability to make it happen. And I did it always, even as a very young boy. And one of the things that Napoleon Hill spoke about that really became a very important item for me in my life was this idea of having what he called this burning desire. And a burning desire is something that is very different than a normal desire that everybody has. Because if you study Buddhist texts, they talk about how it's important to get past desire in your life. And I tried to do that for a while, but I found as long as I'm incarnated into this physical body, desires just go with the program. It seems to me, anyway. I mean, even if you want to go to the bathroom, you know, you got to figure out how to get there. You know, desire just seems to be not something that is so bad. I never thought it was something. Deepak Chopra and I have talked many, many times. In fact, in some of the tapes we've put out together, we've talked about this idea that desire isn't anything that is bad. It's when it becomes something that we become attached to, and I'll talk about that a little bit later in the very first principle. But a burning desire is something very different. And I don't know, I'm not certain about this. I have 8 children, and I watched 5 of them be born. Before that, they didn't even allow men on the same floor, all right? but as I watched these children being born, and I was cutting the cord and holding these tiny little infants who had just showed up in the world, and then I watched them grow, and now they're adults, young adults, and some of them are still teenagers. I have a sense that we come into this world with personalities and with a purpose. Khalil Gibran, the great Lebanese poet, once said that when you are born, your work is placed in your heart. And I have a very strong sense that there's much more to us showing up here in this world and what took place before that. I'm not talking about past lives, although I've read many lives, many masters, and I've talked with Brian Weiss and people like this about this, and certainly I haven't closed myself off to it. But I haven't any internal personal experiences of something called a past life. But I have 8 children, and I've seen those children come in, and the ones that came in and were angry when they showed up and were screaming and hollering and you couldn't get them to get quiet and they wouldn't sleep through the night and they stuck their tongue out at you when you looked at them, now they're in their 20s, and I come home, and they still are angry, and they still are not happy to see me. And the ones that were laughing and happy and slept through the night and were very peaceful, and 18, 20 years later, they seem to be very peaceful. And they said, there's just seem to be, like, we almost come in with personalities, and all, there's hardly a mother.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.